We are gonna set up the brains of our robot today. We chose a Raspberry Pi Zero. And when we've done projects with you guys before, we've pretty much exclusively used microcontrollers. This is a chip on a single board, and it just breaks out that chip so we can use it. And we hook up a USB cable to it, upload a program, and that program just loops again and again and again. And maybe all we have to do for setting it up is install a driver, but that's about it. The Raspberry Pi is very different. It's referred to sometimes as a single board computer. That's because it has its own operating system, it can run multiple files at once, and we can attach peripherals. This pretty much is just like a miniature computer. This means that it's a little bit more involved when we're trying to set it up, but it's totally worth it, except for the part where I burnt my fingers when I tried to install the SD card, but we're gonna get to that later. All the steps in this video are also on our hackster.io page. I wanted you guys to be able to follow along with us, and all the code is on there, so you can just copy and paste it. Don't worry about typing it from anything that you see over here. And I wanna explain a couple of ways to set up your Pi. And this is gonna depend on what kind of equipment you have, what your skill level is, or just generally what your preferences are. And the first method is gonna use a keyboard, a mouse, and an external monitor to set this up. And the second method is going to use just your command line on your computer. This is called headless because there is no screen attached. With either method, we're gonna need to install the operating system, change some system settings, and some preferences. And you're gonna need a microSD card. You can either buy one that has NOOBS already installed on it, or you can use your computer to install it yourself. So if you're gonna do that, the first thing you need to do is format your SD card. I have a Mac, so I went to Disk Utility, and I selected the card that I wanted to put the operating system on, and I hit erase, and I reformatted it as FAT32. And you can get the operating systems for the Raspberry Pi from raspberrypi.org. If you go to the Downloads tab, there are two different ones there. There's NOOBS and there's Rasbian. Now, I was pretty confused by this at first, but NOOBS has Rasbian within it. It's just an easier way to install it. You could just download Rasbian itself, and then you'd have to flash that image onto your SD card using something called Etcher. And this is actually what I did for our Raspberry Pi 3. And when I was doing that, my SD card started to overheat and I burnt my fingers trying to get it out. And when I got it out, it had actually melted and bent in two, and it had nothing at all to do with the installation process. Tim thinks there's probably a short in the SD card, but I did impress Zach because I am very talented. The alternative is that you can download NOOBS itself, unzip that file, copy and paste its contents, and put it into the newly formatted SD card that you have. I haven't tried this process myself, but I hear it might be a little bit slower. And like we said, there are two methods for doing this. There's using all the peripherals, or there's the headless version. You can just skip ahead to this time right here if you want to learn about the headless version. But for the peripherals, I inserted the micro SD card into the Pi, and I used an HDMI adapter to go to the television. And then I used a USB adapter to hook up the Bluetooth keyboard and mouse. And after doing all that is when I plugged the Raspberry Pi into wall power. It's really suggested that you hook up everything and put in the SD card before powering everything on. The Pi will ask you what operating system you want to use. I just chose Rasbian. And then you have to wait for it to install. It's going to take a little bit of time. And as a side note, as we're waiting for it to install, there are different versions of Rasbian out there. There's Stretch and Jesse and Wheezy and all different kinds. And if you're having any problems with your project installing a library or using some other program, you might want to figure out what version you're using of Rasbian and if that one is supported on the library that you're currently using. That's just for troubleshooting in the future. But now that we have Rasbian installed, it's going to ask you to reboot. And once you reboot, it's going to bring you up to the Raspberry Pi desktop. And we're finally there. But there are a couple of preferences that you need to change. There's a Raspberry icon in the upper left-hand corner. I want you to go up to that, click on it, go down to preferences, and then Raspberry Pi config. And there are a few things we want to change. There's a default username and password. The default username is Pi, and the default password for every board is Raspberry. So you definitely want to change that. And when you're done with that, you need to go over to the interfaces tab and change three things. If you want to be able to connect to your Pi from your computer, you want to enable SSH. And if you want to be able to talk to the motors in our later videos, you want to enable I2C and also SPI. And I think then it asks you to reboot again. And when it comes back up, there's one more thing you want to do if you want to be able to talk to your Pi from your computer, and that's enable internet. And the internet icon is in the upper right-hand corner. I forgot to do this when I was doing the Raspberry Pi Zero. I couldn't figure out why my computer couldn't find the Raspberry Pi on the network. But yeah, that's a simple fix. I don't like to code on the Pi itself. I really prefer to code on my computer. It has better code editors, I can search the internet more easily, and be able to copy and paste any code that I find or install libraries and alter things, and it's just a lot easier for me. So I like to set up SSH, which is Secure Shell, and that lets me command into my Pi from my computer. I also like to set up FTP, which is File Transfer Protocol. That lets me alter like a lot of the files that are on the Pi. Not all of them, but most of them. And the last thing I like to do is set up a static IP address, which makes the file transfer part a lot easier. And if you don't want to do that, if all you want to do is use your keyboard, mouse, and the external monitor we just set up, and you can code from there, that's totally fine. This is probably the end of the tutorial for you. But if you want to set up this so you can go into your Pi from your computer, and you don't care about the headless option, which I'm about to go over, you can skip to this timestamp right here, and I'll show you how to do SSH, file transfer, and static IP. For the headless install, you want to go to the boot partition of the SD card that you just either use NOOBS or Etcher to install your operating system. And you want to create a plain text file, and this is going to have your configuration information about your Wi-Fi network. And it's going to be able to connect your Pi to the internet. Replace this generic text right here with your information and save this file as wpa_supplement.config. It might save as a .txt, but you can easily change that extension. Or if you need to go back in and change any information, you want to convert it from a config back to a .txt. And then you need to create a second plain text file just named SSH. There's no extension and there's no text inside. This is a one-time use thing that's going to allow you to connect from your computer to your Pi. Once you do that, once it boots up once, it's never used again. If you need to do it additional times, you're going to keep adding that file. But we're going to change configurations of the Pi later, so you don't have to do that. Now you can put your SD card into the Pi and plug it into wall power, and we can get started. Go to the command line on your computer and then type in SSH space Pi at raspberry.local. I use terminal on my Mac as my command line interface, but I think a lot of Windows users use PuTTY. And if you haven't used command line before, don't worry. I've put links in the description below and also on hackster.io. And there are a few things that we're gonna do, but not too many. We're gonna use SSH to command line into our Pi. We're gonna use the CD function to look at directories in our Pi, the LS function to look at lists of files. We're gonna run our Python programs using Python 3 and then the name of the file. And we might install some libraries as we go along the way. Nothing too bad, and we'll walk you through it. Once you hit enter, it's gonna ask you for a password. This is the default password, which is Raspberry. And we're now accessing the Pi from our computer. If you type in sudo rasp config, we can then change some of the settings. We can use the arrow keys to go up and down in these settings and enter if you want to select anything. And I want us to change our username and our password since they're default for everything. So the password is on the first line that you can change. And then if you go down to network options, it's going to allow you to change the name of the Pi. And then if we go to interface options, there are three things we want to do. We want to enable SSH. This is going to allow us to command in from our computer to our Pi more than once. We'll just leave this on and we'll always be able to do it, unlike that file that we did in the beginning. Then we also want to enable SPI and I2C. This is going to let us talk to our motors in future videos. And then we should probably reboot our Pi. And then when it comes back up again, we can use the command line and SSH space Pi at, and then whatever name that you just gave it. Hit enter and use your new password. And then we have two more things we want to do. The first is give it a static IP address. If you type in ipconfig, it's going to tell you what the current one is for your Pi. You can use this one or a different one on your network that's not already in use. And then we use sudo nano and the name of this file right here. Sudo means super user do. It's like admin permissions almost, and it's giving you higher level ones, like if you want to install something or open something. Nano is a text editor that we can use, and that's what's opening this file right here. We'll scroll down to the bottom and you can add this text with the IP address that you want to use. And then to get out of there, you want to hit exit to save. And I always get stuck in this loop where I'm hitting exit and cancel and exit and cancel. Enter is the real exit in the Nano program. Then you can reboot the Pi using sudo reboot. To shut down in the future, you can use sudo shutdown or sudo halt. And when it comes up this time, we can use SSH space Pi at 92.168.1. whatever your new IP address is. In the future, if you want to use this and not have to remember what the static IP address is all the time, you can always scroll up to and it will show you the last command that you did. The last thing I want to do is to set up the file transfer protocol. and I set up Netatalk via the command line. So that accessed my Pi and set it up on there. And then on my Mac, I hit Command K, and this brought up this pop-up window right here. And for the server address, I just used the static IP that we created. And the name is always Pi, and not the one you created, but the password is the new one that you used. If you're a window user, I think Fillezilla is commonly used. And there we go, we've done it. We have set up our Raspberry Pi. We're ready to start building the rest of the robot. We can 3D print parts and set up our motors. And if you have any questions or comments, let us know down below. Thank you so much for learning with us today, and we will see you next time.